Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to Professor Dr. Prateek Rastogi. With blessings of Dr. Ranjit Singh, sir, we have got this opportunity to have sir among us. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and taking out time for us. Today, sir will be delivering the session on the topic Autopsy on Unclaimed Bodies, Practical Issues. Sir, we are very keen to know the facts behind that. But before that, I request my co-host Mani to give brief insight about your doings to the audience. Thank you, sir. Over to you, Mani.
Thank you so much, Astha, and very good morning to everyone. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Prateek Rastogi, who is going to talk to us about the autopsies of unclaimed bodies. This is a subject in which we should all be deeply interested to know. Sir, although having spent almost his entire career working in this field, and today he's here with us to enlighten our knowledge regarding that topic. Let's have a look for his professional journey. Sir is working as a professor and head department of forensic and medicine toxicology, Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore. He was former professor and head of forensic medicine and toxicology department at Sikkim Manipal University Institute of Medical Science, Gangtok, and former president, Indian Society of Toxicology in 2018-19. He completed his MBBS in 2002 from Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, and MD in 2005 from Kasturba Medical College, Manipal, under Manipal Academy of Higher Education, Manipal, Karnataka. He also holds certification in various fields like bioethics, forensic identification, introduction to toxicology, etc. He has published 140 articles and he participated in 66 conferences and 204 CMEs and workshops. He presented 43 papers. He delivered 41 guest lectures at national and international levels. He is a member and life member of 14 medical bodies, member of editorial and advisory board of 15 journals and 3 books, peer reviewer of 37 journals in medical field. He contributed chapters to 6 forensic medicine textbooks. He published 16 e-books on Amazon Kindle and contributed in various capacities of 18 other e-books on Amazon Kindle. He was awarded with Young Investigator Award by Asia Pacific Academic Consortium for Public Health in 2010, Certificate of Appreciation for Excellence in Research and Publications by KMC Mangalore, Certificate of Appreciation for Commitment as a Member of Disaster Management Team in 2010, Air India Mishap at Mangalore, Manipal University. He has got distinguished alumni award KMC Mangalore in 2015, and he's a recipient of felicitation by Akhil Bhartiya Harish Chandra Vanshiya Mahasabha in 2016. Sir, words are not enough to define a work done by you. Thank you so much for being here with us today. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Mani, for introducing sir so beautifully. The platform is all yours, sir.
Thank you, Mani, Astha, and the other members of SIFS and Dr. Ranjit for inviting me here to give this brief talk. I'll try my best to do the justice to the platform provided. I'll start sharing my screen.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Are my slides visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So very good morning to all of you. Having a relaxed Sunday and listening to a talk on autopsy and that too on unknown and unclaimed bodies. So I'm Dr. Prateek. I'm professor at Kasturba Medical College, Bangalore. Let us start with some quotes. Unknown is one who unknown dies. I am not going into, what does this course means. We'll see how we proceed, that what is the significance of this word unknown or unknown death or unidentified death in the forensic field. We all are afraid of unknown things. And you know, it's quite a challenge sometimes when we do the postmortem on the unknown dead bodies for various reasons. We'll go through them in detail as we proceed. Before we start the practical implications of working on unknown or unwanted bodies or unclaimed bodies, let us be clear with some of the common terminologies which we use day to day and which will be used in this particular talk also. Unclaimed. It means anything which is not claimed or has no ownership. Unwanted, which is not required by anyone or is not needed by anyone. Although the words appear similar, but yes, they have different meaning. Unknown. Person might have claimants, might be wanted by someone, but he is not known, is not familiar. Wherever the person is or the thing is, it's not known to anyone. Unidentified, which is not recognized. So these are the few common, similar looking terminologies, but clearly they have somewhat different meanings. We can say that unknown and unidentified are somewhat similar, and unclaimed and unwanted are somewhat similar terms. Let me start with some of the cases which we have done here at our center. And we have done postmortem on that and disposed of the PM report. The first case was of a 60 to 65 year old unknown male who was found unconscious on the railway platform. He was wearing a lungi and a shirt. His pockets contained an unreserved train ticket for Mumbai. He was declared brought dead to hospital. He was shifted by the railway police to the hospital. The hospital authorities declared him brought dead. And as a protocol, the body was subjected for post-mortem examination. Why after 3 days? Because, it's a... guidelines also, some regulations also, we'll not go into details of those regulations and guidelines, but at most of the setups, the bodies, unknown or unclaimed bodies, are kept for 2 to 3 days, or in other words, 48 to 72 hours, in order to trace the claimants, in order to make the proper identification. So in this case, the postmortem was ordered after 3 days. On external and internal examination, no injuries were present. We preserved the organs for histopathological examination. We preserved viscera as he was brought dead. All the findings were negative. So there were no injuries present on the body. There were no findings on histopathology as well as RFSL analysis. Although the person was old age and we presume that it is a natural death, so we gave the cause of death remains uncertain. However, possibility of death due to natural causes cannot be ruled out. So this was the first case. Let us go to case number two. I hope the first case is very clear to all. This is the ideal situation. This is the situation faced by most of us in the mortuary. An unknown body will be brought and we do postmortem after 2 to 3 days. We tend to look for injuries and investigations. If some findings are there, that gives us the cause of death. If not, it remains unascertained. Or if we find something to suggest a natural death, maybe a coronary disease, maybe a pathology in some other organ, we directly give it as natural death. So that's a very common scenario. When we see this case number two, this person was found unconscious and was brought to the hospital. He was admitted to the hospital for around 1 month, but he didn't gain consciousness. And later he expired. Diagnosis of stroke was made as his scan showed basal ganglia necrosis. I'm not projecting here all the findings of the case. The gist was that hospital authorities diagnosed it to be a case of stroke. The body was subjected for post-mortem examination, which confirmed the scan findings. The cause of death was opined as cerebral necrosis due to natural causes. We did histopathology also, and we took the help of hospital case sheet based on which this opinion was given. Now, here just a thought for all of you. Maybe we can discuss it at the end of the talk. In hospital, there was a diagnosis of stroke made. Scan also showed positive diagnosis. Still, the body was subjected for post-mortem examination, which confirmed the scan findings. And, you know, there was not much difference between the cause of death, as which was given after post-mortem examination, or which was given when he died in the hospital. Now, just a query from my side, we can discuss it later, that is post-mortem necessary in such a situation when there is clear-cut diagnosis made at the hospital? We are not, I'm not making any statement here, but just for something for you to think. Let us see this case number three. A 45 to 50 year old emaciated unknown male was found lying on the roadside and brought to hospital for treatment. Here the patient was not unconscious. The patient was conscious. The patient was diagnosed to be suffering from pulmonary tuberculosis and died in hospital after 2 months of treatment. Here also, body was subjected for post-mortem examination, which confirmed the diagnosis of tuberculosis. In both case number two and three, when we asked the police why the post-mortem is required, they said, sir, as the person was unknown, so as per our guidelines, we are conducting post-mortem or unknown bodies. Now, the point to note here is, in both these cases, the positive diagnosis was made. In first, stroke diagnosis was made. In this one, TB diagnosis was made. There was one more difference between the two cases. In case number two, the patient was unconscious. In case number three, the patient had gained consciousness. He was unknown. Later, he died unclaimed, although they came to know about his name and other details, but there were no claimants for this person after he died, nor he had any bystanders during the time of his treatment in the hospital. Still, the body was subjected for post-mortem examination, which confirmed the diagnosis. I know there might be some queries at this stage. We can pick it up later. Please keep noting your queries. Let us go to case number four. Herein, an unknown person aged about 60 to 70 years was found dead on the roadside. Body was preserved in cool chamber for 2 months before post-mortem. Although most of the states, the guideline says to keep for 48 to 72 hours for identification, then conduct the post-mortem examination. Here, the body was preserved in cool chamber for 2 months for the reasons best known to the police. Autopsy showed a partially decomposed body without any sign of external and internal trauma. Histopathology, autolysis of tissues, RFSL was negative for poison. The documents which we observed, which we examined, which were made in the hospital at the time of keeping the body in the cold chamber, it clearly showed that body was not in decomposed state at the time of keeping it in the cold chamber. Now, kindly see that we did a post-mortem on a decomposed body, and we all know once you do post-mortem on a decomposed body, a lot of findings which you can make out at the initial time gets masked. Even your histopathology may not reveal anything significant. So this was another scenario, right? Let us move on to case number five. A middle-aged manual worker collapsed at work and was shifted to hospital. He was diagnosed to be suffering from coronary artery disease in the hospital. He died after being hospitalized for 1 week. There were no whereabouts of him. He was a manual worker. He was a laborer. There were no other whereabouts for him, except his name, as he joined work at the construction site only on that day. None of his colleagues knew about him. Here also, although the diagnosis of coronary artery disease was made in the hospital, there were no external findings. There was no other suspicion, but the body was subjected for post-mortem examination, which again confirmed the clinical diagnosis. Now here it is different from case number two and case number three, because on the same day he was admitted and same day he died. Anyway, I know some queries might be there. We'll see the things as the talk progresses. So these are the five cases. I just wanted to start with these cases so as to give you a brief idea about what we are up to in this particular talk. When you talk about autopsy, any autopsy procedure has the following objectives. First thing is identification of the dead body if the body is unidentified, estimation or determination of cause of death of the deceased, to throw some light on manner of death, although that is not totally under the purview of the forensic pathologist. It's a lot of times it is related to investigating authorities to comment on manner of death, but yes, we can always help them out with some guidelines or some findings which can throw some light on manner of death. Estimation of time since death if the death was not a witnessed one. So these are the basic objectives of doing an autopsy. Now we say even in the case of unknown bodies, identification is of preliminary importance. That's why the death is autopsied. Identification of unknown, it has to pass through various findings which helps us to identify an unknown dead body. There are various procedures which are taken up by the police and the investigating authorities to establish the identification of the unknown. One of the commonest and the most oldest one is to give the details of the dead body, or maybe even the photograph or some findings or some belongings details or the location where the body was found. That news is circulated in the newspapers. Radio channels are another mode, although not so common in present time, but yes, they are used, they were used, or they can be used for getting some idea about the identification. TV, showing the photograph or the details or the whereabouts of the dead body on the television might reach a wider media, and an identification can be made by the near and dear ones if they are having a missing person. In the present time, the most common one is internet. Even in our WhatsApp group, sometimes we find, you know, that something is found here, something is found there, although no one talks much about the dead body. But yes, that is also one of the media or the news on the internet, because nowadays the habit of reading newspaper or seeing the news on TV or radio channel is not so common. Rather, all of us scroll down on the internet on our mobile phones and we see for the news, and there also we can get the information. And in fact, it is a very fast way of circulating the information to a wider audience for the purpose of identification. There are other sources, like if the person is missing, the missing person reports might be available in the police stations. So even the police stations have the mechanism, they communicate with their near police stations, or you know, from where they suspect the body or the person to be, based on what all partial identification means are available. And these all can be used to spread information or to collect information about any either a missing person or about a recovered, unknown, unclaimed dead body. Identification is mainly based on clothings. Okay. Not only on clothing, but yes, it is one of the main characteristics. Sometimes we find the body in the decomposed or the putrefied state, in which, you know, the facial features or the other things might not be so clear. In that case, clothing may help us to identify. The belongings which are found along with the dead body or with an unconscious or unknown person, sometimes what happens is some belongings might be there, some ID cards, some ornaments, wallet. So all those things might help us to identify the person. If the body is in the process, if is not in the process of being decomposed or dismembered, or is not unrecognizable, then the facial features form the main backbone of identification. This is what is used by clicking the photographs in any media. If you want to circulate photographs, you want to put it in the police station, again photographs, or even while filing the missing report person, the person will be giving the photographs. So most of the things are based on facial features. But as we all know, in a lot of cases, facial features might not be recognizable. Certain peculiar body characteristics and deformities, like limp in one leg or some extra finger, missing fingers. I always give an example of, you know, famous film star Hrithik Roshan, that, you know, one identification point of for him is having six fingers in one of the hand. So any body characteristics, any deformities, if documented properly and, you know, conveyed properly, may help us in identification of the unknown. Even when we are doing postmortem, these are the some characteristics which we, you know, make sure to note while while making our documentation in the postmortem report. Very common things like tattoos, scars, moles, or birthmarks, their exact location, type, size, color, any other peculiar features, all those things can help us in identification, and it is always advisable to make a note of him, these things, when we are dealing with an unknown body. Common scientific methods like fingerprints, one of the most foolproof one, most widely accepted. Other prints, footprints, lip prints, horoscopy, although, you know, it's not so easy to identify a person peculiarly by these things because the record keeping and other things are also an issue. But yes, if available, they can also help us in identification, or we can collect these things for further identification. DNA, one of the most talked after thing for a positive identification. It has a lot of advantages. It has a lot of disadvantages. Advantages going towards a more confirmative diagnosis, a more foolproof one. DNA is preserved even in the decomposed bodies for a long time. Okay, even after a long time, you can do this type of investigation. Very small amount of DNA is required. So all those are advantages for DNA. Disadvantages may be you have to compare it with someone. So you need to know where you want to compare. It should be a proper technique. It should be done in a proper way. There should not be any mistake or problems with the technique. Another important issue in a developing country like ours is we do not have a DNA database of our population. In fact, it is a rare possibility also, seeing the present scenario in the population of our country. Another problem with that is, cost factor. Although we may say when we talk, it may cost 500,000, 1500, depending on the centers. But yes, DNA analysis is not done at all the centers. In fact, I'm going to talk about one more case a little later, and I'll talk to you about the problems which we had with DNA identification also. So tattoos are, you know, very common things which we usually found on most of the bodies, so they can be helped, documented, photographed, and based on that, the identification can be made. It is not as simple as it appears. There are a lot of problems and challenges while dealing with an unknown, unidentified, unclaimed, unwanted body. Not only in identification, but still there are further more challenges which we face. Most problematic situation we feel with the decomposed bodies. Whenever we encountered these decomposed bodies, they're usually in such a state, there will be maggots, there will be, you know, facial features or the body features might not be recognizable because of bloating of the bodies or because of oozing out of the body fluids. Sometimes even the clothing might not be in the exact state in which they were before death of the person. And there are always challenges and issues. If you want to wash them and identify, you may miss a lot of other evidences at that time. Even the photographs, if you take of these decomposed bodies, they do not give the correct or the clear picture. So there are a lot of issues with the decomposed bodies. And even when we are doing postmortem, there is sometimes some aversion with a lot of pathologists also, and the workers while handling these bodies, because it is not a pleasant sight. It's not a pleasant sight. A lot of times you will find the maggots or the flies on the body. So a lot of issues while dealing with the decomposed bodies. Dismembered remains. Only some body parts are available. There might be a mass disaster. Multiple accidents might have taken place. Few bodies are present side by side. You don't know which limb belongs to whom. So there are a lot of things you have to not only establish the identification of the intact body, but you also need to establish the identity of those dismembered remains. Because in most of the cultures, it's a belief that if you want to bury or even cremate the dead body, it should be the entire body or the entire body parts. Then only the body can, soul is relieved from this world. So there are a lot of other issues with these dismembered remains. Skeletonized remains, still more problematic. Only bones are found. So we don't know. Nowadays, first problem is to make out whether they are bones or not, because there are a lot of artificial bones available, and especially with the medical students, made of plaster of Paris and other material. So skeletonized remains, then you make out whether they are human or animal, and then race, age, sex, stature, a lot of things, not very difficult to do, but yes, it's a task to do all these examinations. Commingling of body parts. As I talked in while talking about dismembered remains, whenever there is a mass disaster, like an air crash, a railway disaster, so in that type, the body parts might get separated and they might be available at different location or mixed with the body parts of the other individuals. So in that stage, again, the identification becomes difficult. Unrecognizable facial features, we have already discussed about that. As we all know, face is one of the most common thing which helps us in identification. So if facial features itself are unrecognizable, it's not so simple to identify an unknown body. These are some of the photographs from our own cases in our own mortuary. So where facial features are not so clear and other features are also not easily seen. Yes, we can go ahead with the identification, but we can only give a broad idea, maybe age, sex, or race, or stature of the person, but a positive identification may not be so easy. A lot of times we get these bones for examination, we need to sort them out, we see how many individuals they belong to, male or female, same age or different age, same individual or multiple individual, trauma or not. So a lot of these issues are there. Continuing with problems and challenges in unknown bodies, a lot of times you may not find, it is very easy to say, document an identification mark, but a lot of times you may not find any prominent or available identification mark. Or if available, it might be present on some hidden parts of the body, like on the private parts or usually on some covered areas of the body, which only the victim might have known. So even if you document those identification marks, they may not help us in a proper identification later on. No clothing or belongings. It's very common not to have any belongings along with the person. Although most of the time we find clothing, but again, there are issues with that. Ambiguous information will be there. See, gone are the olden times where people used to get their clothes stitched. They used to go to a particular tailor. The name of that tailor will be there. If you go back to the tailor will have the records. Okay, this dress I have made for this, because he might have some measurements, some other peculiarities, some other different type of stitching pattern. But nowadays, it is a time of ready-made clothes. The same brand, same Louis Philippe, same Peter England, might be worn by hundreds and thousands of people all around the world. What information you can get? You might not even get the information of whether it was purchased from a particular store or not. Whether it was purchased online or offline, that also we don't know. So clothing may not give us a very clear information. Yes, if it is a very costly brand, you can say that it person belongs to some upper middle class or an upper class of the body, of the society. But other than that, having another information may not be so easy. We say record the fingerprints or other prints, but are they actually in a recordable state? Can you actually collect that? Let a lot of practical problems we face while handling these situations. Okay, if you collect it also, you need to compare them with some things. Just having the fingerprint of the person in a country like ours is not sufficient. We do not have a database of the fingerprints of the entire population. So you need to have a data for comparison. You need to have a suspicious person who was missing. Not only that, you need to have the fingerprints or other prints available of that person to identify, to make a proper identification. So unavailability of data for comparison is a big problem. You have everything, but there is no missing person report in vicinity. Quite common in present times. Now the world is a global village. The people travel from one part of the country to another, one part of the world to another. He might be missing from one area. The body is found in another area. Body might be found in, you know, missing from Delhi, found in Mangalore. Missing person report is filed in Delhi. If the relatives or the family members know that he has traveled to Mangalore, fine enough. If they don't know, or they are not very clear, or the person is usually on the traveling jobs, lot of issues. Another problem in the city like ours in Mangalore, we are a coastal city. You know, there have been situations when the body have been flown from the coast of Kerala. We are hardly 10 kilometers from the Kerala border, recovered in Mangalore. The missing person report might be in the Kerala police station. We are finding the body here. Again, all those issues are there. Although I'm not saying it can be sorted out. Police does a wonderful work in searching these things. But yes, these are problems and challenges. Bodies recovered from place of origin or death. Cause factor. The person is unknown. There are no claimants. Who is interested? Yes, when the police does the investigation, it's the government money which is used. But till there is no person to force that investigation, who is willing to spend that money also? Okay, government will spend, police will spend, but otherwise, how much to pursue that investigation? So those all issues are there. No relatives or family members have come forward to file a missing person report. The person does not have a relative or family member. So again, the identification becomes very, very difficult. Destitutes, beggars, they might have a relative or family members who are not willing for identification for the reasons best known to them. Yes, might look little odd, but it happens. The person might have deserted them, or they might have deserted the family member. They might have seen that news in the newspaper or channels. They're not willing to come forward for identification. They don't want to claim that body. Body is damaged beyond recognition. This point I have discussed enough number of times in this talk also. Charred bodies, drowning cases, bodies recovered after a few days, damaged beyond recognition. In these also, problems and challenges are there for recognition. If you are able to recognize the body or identify the body, or you are not able to identify the body, but finally you have to end up with disposal of the body. Although I agree, as medical men, it is not our concern how the body will be disposed of. But yes, there are a lot of issues with the administration and with the law enforcing agencies. Or if some of us are related to some hospitals where these unknown people die. So there are a lot of issues. Religious reasons. If you are not able to identify the body properly, in what way you are going to dispose it? Might be a Hindu, a Muslim, a Sikh, a Parsi, belonging to some other religion. All the religions have different beliefs. How are we going to dispose? Although there are government protocols and guidelines which does that, but yes, there are issues. What if later on you are able to identify that body after disposal? Cost factor, who will bear the cost of disposal? Although it's not, mostly these people or the bodies are shifted to government hospitals where the government or municipality bears it. Sometimes they are handed over to some NGOs or some voluntary organizations who bear the cost. So in present day, because of public awareness and a lot of social organizations and government bodies coming up, this cost factor is not such a big problem right now. If there is a doubt or there is a suspicion on the manner of death, even though if you know the religion, are you going to burn the body or bury the body, or how you are going to dispose? All those issues have to be taken care of by the investigating officer before they take a call on disposal of the body. In this present corona pandemic, especially in the first wave of corona, we have seen, because of high infectivity, or about the news about the high infectivity, there was issues related to disposal of the known dead bodies. The relatives were not coming forward. The local authorities, the local people were not coming forward. There were objections when the body was taken for disposal in particular areas. Forget about the unknown bodies. Where are we going to dispose them? Although now, with the subsidization of the first wave, people becoming more aware. In the second wave of corona, we have not found that problem much. It is still, you know, some problems related to handling of the bodies. But yes, the disposal issues have become much more streamlined. Unknown or unclaimed bodies may be used for organ harvesting, for academic purpose, for treatment purpose. The bodies or organs can be used in research. There are issues, there are guidelines, there are protocols, there are permissions which needs to be taken. We'll not go into details of all these things. But these are also issues when we deal with at the time of disposal. If proper permissions are obtained or proper, you know, we handle it improperly, we can utilize these things for organ harvesting or for research. But again, there are legal and ethical issues. It should not be misused. Those freedoms should not be misused. Now, let me come and talk to you about this case. On 22nd May 2010, the city of Mangalore experienced an air crash. It was an Air India flight which was coming from Dubai. It was IX812, if I remember correctly. It was moving from, it moved from Dubai. It was supposed to land at Mangalore Airport. For some reasons, it couldn't land properly. And on that fateful day, on the morning of 22nd May 2010, we got the news. This was done in Mangalore with the collaboration of all the medical colleges at Mangalore. This postmortem examination was done on 158 dead bodies. This article has been published in Medical Legal Journal. I'm sure some of you might have read it also. If not, I've given the full reference as well as the link of that article is there. This is how this article was published. There were a lot of issues which we faced. See, cause of death was not of much issue in this 158 postmortems, except for the dead bodies of the pilot and the co-pilot, which were dealt differently. But in most of the other cases, the only issue of doing postmortem was unidentified body. The main purpose was to identify the dead bodies and hand them over to the relatives. The government Wenlock Hospital mortuary in Mangalore handled almost 130 to 135 dead bodies out of that. Rest all were distributed amongst the other medical colleges which are present in Mangalore. These all postmortems were done over a period of almost 1.5 days. We faced a lot of challenges while we were dealing with these cases. First of all, there was no trained disaster victim identification team. When the air crashes happened, at that time, the local people, the police, the media, everyone were available at the site, but we never had a trained disaster victim identification. Because of which, a lot of problems happened on the crime scene. On that site, a lot of evidence was probably missed or, you know, misplaced. I'll not exactly use the word missed, but misplaced, because the primary objective of the people at that time, what they were looking for, if someone is alive, they wanted to save him. They wanted to recover all the dead bodies. So in the larger interest, in the larger thoughts, they might have acted. So the minor thoughts about identification or how to handle the body, because a lot of things look good on paper. When we say this should be done, this should be done. But practically, when you are seeing 158 dead bodies, a burned airplane with a lot of media, public, politicians everywhere, and a lot of pressure and issues are there, even on the district administration. And there was no DVI, trained DVI team available at that moment. We were totally unprepared at that time for the past disaster. You know, disasters come. They don't tell us before coming that they are coming. They just land up. So we were not totally prepared to handle that mass disaster at that time. ideally, in these cases, one option is to do an on-site autopsy. But an open terrain with a burned aircraft, rainy morning, thousands of people available, it was really difficult to do on-site autopsy. So all 158 bodies were shifted to mortuary. Belongings were collected on site unscientifically. It was not intentional. It was unintentionally it has happened because the primary target of police, primary objective of police and the other people were to collect those belongings so that relatives can identify. In between what has happened, the proper tagging and identification could not be done. So later on, we had all the belongings, we had the things, but it was very difficult to match with the dead bodies. Relatives could identify the belongings, but how to identify they belong to which part? So belongings were not marked properly at that time. Bodies were charred beyond recognition. In a lot of bodies, we only found some body parts like legs, head, or something. They were charred beyond recognition. Another issue was, it is always easy for biological relatives to identify them. But the flight was coming from Dubai, some relatives were somewhere. So what they did was, not the biological, but the geographical closest relatives who were present in the vicinity, they were the ones who were involved in identification. Now, they were dealing only based on the normal identification features which they might have known, or what the actual family members, what the biological relatives might have told them on phone. And another problem what happened was, even the Mangalore airport was to be closed at that time. So even it was not so easy for biological relatives also to reach there. So most of the identification was done by geographical relatives, which we all can understand might not be so good as will be done by biological relatives. It is easier said than done, DNA-related issues. 158 dead bodies, thousands of relatives, media persons, public. Is it possible to collect DNA in all the cases? See, still, till time, we always believe on the identification done by the relatives. They are the people who known the diseased person better. So DNA was not collected in all the bodies. In fact, only in 22 bodies which were not claimed at the end of that 1.5 to 2 days, we collected the DNA sample. Later on, we may say there might be an argument. Some of you also might have an issue. Why DNA was not collected initially? But practically, is it possible at that moment? Okay, if you collect also, you have to wait till you get all the relatives, get their DNA samples, match it. Where to store all these dead bodies at that time? Do we have that much of facilities to store those so many dead bodies? Just having a mass disaster doesn't mean that the routine deaths doesn't happen or routine postmortem cases doesn't come. Where to store? So all those problems were there. Even DNA, when only partial identification is done, we might not have both the father or mother at all the times. So what if the body belongs to father and son, to the siblings? Unless you do a correct profiling or you have the exact sample, it is really not possible to identify with so much of correctness. Unavailability of DNA database. Simply connected DNA is not enough. You have to match it with someone. So in some cases, you might not have a ready availability of comparison sample. Another problem is, at Mangalore, we don't have a DNA matching center. The samples were sent to CFSL Hyderabad. In fact, there was a team which arrived from there and collected the samples. So again, coming, going, matching, sending the reports. In fact, it took a few days. So 22 bodies were not a problem to identify, to keep. We kept it. But at the end also, some 11 bodies remained unidentified. So it's not only that 11, that means that 11 were unidentified and there were some other 11 people who have taken the wrong bodies. That's very obvious. And it also raises an issue that were all the other bodies which were identified earlier were correct identification or not. So all those problems were there. Unavailability of antemortem records, that is a peculiar problem. Everywhere we face it, we don't have the antemortem records of most of the people, or if available also, we don't know from where to track them. In this particular case, there was a lot of political issues involved, media and public. I'll not go into the details of that, but I hope all of you understand that these issues create more problem rather than doing the work at the place. Who has the authority for identification? Do the doctor has? No. It's mostly the investigating officer or the relatives. If relative, even in the routine postmortems, what identification we make? The police tells us this person, relatives are identifying it to the police. Police comes and identifies it to us and we do it. Same thing happened in this particular case also. If relative says, this is my relative who has died, we hand over the body. There is no other means for us not to believe them. Another thing, announcement of financial compensation at the time when even the postmortem works were not. I'm not raising a doubt on the intentions of the relatives, but yes, some factor comes that you have to claim a dead body. If it is matching a little bit also, fine, maybe your own relative, what's wrong if you get some compensation? So just what all I have talked, just a summary of these things is coming in legal issues. There are issues of preserving an unknown dead body, who will preserve, how long to preserve, when to do an autopsy, whether autopsy is required or not, how to dispose that unknown dead body. So all these are the legal issues which usually the law enforcing authorities decide and they take a call on it. There are a lot of ethical and humanitarian issues. I have discussed all these things. It's just a brief summary of what all I have discussed in these. There may be delay in disposal because of identification, religious matters related to identification, carelessness and callous attitude sometimes because there are no near and dear ones, no kith and kin. So who takes the responsibility? Cause factors, using of organs for harvesting or supply of dead bodies to medical colleges, although these things are very much streamlined law. What to do in the cases of highly infective unknown dead bodies and whether an autopsy is required or not in all the cases are the various issues. Just I'll take 5 to 7 minutes more of yours. I hope I have that much time before I conclude this particular talk. Let us talk about few practical scenarios which we face while handling these unknown dead bodies. I am sure all of you who are belong to forensic medicine specialty might have dealt with some of these scenarios in your day-to-day practice. An unknown person is found dead on the roadside. No doubt, no suspicion about it. Autopsy need to be done and identification needs to be done. There is no doubt, person is unknown, you have to establish the identity. He's found dead, there may be a chances of foul play. There is no doubt about conducting postmortem in this particular scenario. An unknown person is found unconscious and brought dead to the hospital. Somewhat similar to the first scenario, here also no doubts. We need to go ahead with the postmortem examination. Not only to establish the identity, but also to estimate the or to determine the cause of death. An unknown person is found unconscious, brought to hospital, died before any definitive diagnosis. Again, PM. This is again a complicated way of writing, brought dead. Dead on arrival, all those things, no, found dead, brought dead, or dead on arrival. In all these cases, because there may be a probability of foul play, we need to conduct a postmortem. These are the very common practical scenarios we see in our day-to-day practice. A person walks into casualty. He might be suffering from something. He collapses there. No bystanders or identity-related documents. Yes, he is also dead on arrival. I'm not saying only walks into casualty, he might be brought by someone into the casualty, alive at that time, collapses there, dies, there are no relatives, no one, you are not sure of the diagnosis, postmortem examination needs to be done. There is partial identification of the person or the body. An ID card might be there, a name tag might be there, some other whereabouts might be there, but it's not a complete identification. It only is giving you a partial identification. You have tried to trace. There is no person living at that address. You don't know about his relatives or kith or kin. There is a doubtful diagnosis of disease or cause of death. Again, you need to do a postmortem. But again, a query. If diagnosis of disease or cause of death is confirmed, do we still go ahead with the postmortem? An unknown person was found unconscious, admitted to hospital, survives for a few days, identity not established, but a positive diagnosis is made and cause of death can be established, somewhat similar to the cases which I have discussed earlier. Just think on it. Do we still need a postmortem examination on such a body? We get such requests. We have been doing postmortem on that. But is it really required? An unknown person found unconscious, admitted to the hospital, gain unconscious, no bystanders or relatives, diagnosis of illness made, patient dies. Cause of death is known. Patient was not unconscious. Only thing is, he is unclaimed. So do we still need to do postmortem? I know in a lot of jurisdictions, postmortems are not done, but in our jurisdiction here, we repeatedly get requests to do postmortems on such bodies. I still do not know after so many years that what exactly are we going to gain from the postmortem on these bodies. You cannot comment anything more on the cause of death. How much identity you can establish after postmortem? What all samples, what all things you need to collect, you can collect it without doing postmortem also, or max to max by external examination. But yes, we get such requests and cases are being done. We get requests to collect fingerprints. A lot of times police themselves collect it. If not, sometimes they ask us to collect it, especially in some, you know, in certain cases. Requests for belongings, they will give it to us. They also document, we also document, then we hand over these belongings to them. Request for collecting samples for DNA, yes, routinely done and routinely present. There are two other peculiar requests. Request for collecting fingertips, for collecting fingerprints at later stage. I still do not know from the learned audience, if someone wants to comment on it later, can comment. What is the significance of collecting these fingertips? Why can't we collect fingerprints then and there? Is it not like mutilating a dead body? We have even got a request for decapitating the unknown body. I understand if it is the skeletalized remains or the skull has been separated, fine, you can collect it for superimposition. But is it justified? Is it humane to decapitate an unknown dead body and to give that skull to the investigating authorities for superimposition? I'm not sure if such type of requests are available at other centers also. We have received such requests. We have refused it. We have justified it. And till date, we have not faced any problems, even after refusal. But yes, we keep on getting these requests. So when we deal with an unknown dead body, we need to make attempts at identification. We need to see whether a foul play is there or not. Mainly these are under the purview of investigating officer. They decide whether an autopsy needs to be done or not. If autopsy needs to be done, we preserve all the samples and try to make with our best capabilities the efforts for identification. A lot of information in this present talk has been taken from this chapter written by me only in Dr. Gautam Vishwa's textbook, Recent Advances in Forensic Medicine and Toxicology. In fact, the case scenarios which have been mentioned have been documented there also. This book is also available. You can go through that if you want. Online also, it is available free of cost. Some information. So a lot of information I have picked up from this chapter written by me only. So that's all from my side.
Thank you so much, sir, for enriching us with such good words and sharing the details on how identification is done in unknown cases and problems and challenges faced related to that and much more. In this honor, we request you to kindly accept the certificate as a token of appreciation for our side, from our side. SIFS is gladly presenting you this certificate for delivering an expert talk on autopsy on unclaimed bodies, practical issues. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us and enhancing our knowledge. It was really an interesting talk. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Asta. And once again, thank you so much, Prateek, sir.
Thank you, Team SIFS, for giving me this opportunity to share my views. And thanks to all my senior teachers and all who have participated and given very well full, very good insights and thoughts into that. Thank you, all of you.